Thank you very much. It is really first an honor and a pleasure to be in Ljubljana. I would like to, of course, thank Professor Kaučić and Professor Damian for the invitation. I would also, of course, like to thank you all for coming. I will be speaking, let me just give, after such a beautiful introduction, it seems like I really should not even speak anymore, because really Jože was extremely kind in bringing up all the sort of parts of the work that have been quoted recently. So over some of the slides, I think actually I might even go a little bit faster than usual. So let me just put the parameters, since I really don't want to speak all the time, and I would really love to have like a little bit of a discussion and to give opportunity to people to ask questions. I would speak for about maybe, and usually you would tell me when I should stop, maybe about 40 minutes, 35 to 40 minutes, and then we will discuss things. So let me start, of course, with the book that, well, of course, we have always to have a little bit of a sort of advertisement in the beginning. The book which actually I will discuss today, I will not discuss only the book. It is not going to be a traditional book talk. It will be a little bit broader. But lots of things here are based on the book, which is Global Inequality. Now, I have to define just, I know that it's boring, but I have to define what global inequality means. First of all, what global means. Obviously, by definition, it is the whole world. But inequality in this particular case really is inequality of income. So what I've been doing in this book and in quite a few years of my work was essentially trying to combine information mostly from household surveys from like as many countries in the world as I can. I will show you later maybe about 120 countries in each year, and then essentially get their distributions of income, put them all together into kind of unified overall distribution of income, and then use something which is called purchasing power parity, which I will not explain in detail, but basically it is used to adjust for the differences in price levels, so that we have, in principle, comparable incomes. What it means is everybody who travels knows that obviously Norway is much more expensive than, let's say, Slovenia. Slovenia is more expensive than Algeria. Algeria is more expensive than India. So we do have to adjust incomes by the price level. So that's the second component. So basically there are two components. One is data from household service, another one is the adjustment for the price differences. And then you put it all together and you have something which is called global income inequality. So this is what I'm going to talk about today. But before I do that, because of course this is not something that we really normally think about, because we don't think of the world as a single unit, we really think mostly about inequalities within our own countries, or maybe some neighboring countries, or just sort of a, you know, perception of inequality having risen in the US is very much present among many people. So let me just show you first a little bit about what happened to inequalities within nations. Now this is the data, as you can see, from the 1950s, and on the vertical axis you see the Gini coefficient, which is a measure of inequality. So that Gini coefficient ranges in principle from zero, which is a theoretical situation where everybody has the same income, to 100, which is also a theoretical possibility of one person having the entire income. Now, I always like to, when I teach, when I talk about that in Europe, it's actually everywhere except the United States, it's very easy to give people a feeling how big the Gini should be. Because I tell them, think of the Gini like the Celsius scale. So, nice weather, pleasant weather is like 20, 25, 30, maybe 32 degrees. It's warm, it's pleasant. And that's actually where many of the countries that are actually having relatively reasonable, relatively low levels of inequality are. But then as you go further, you come, and most of the OECD countries are below 35. I will come to Slovenia a little bit later, but Slovenia is about 25 and 27. So very nice, pleasant weather. But then you come to 40, plus 40, it's really hot, and that's where, for example, big countries are, the United States, China, and Russia, so above 40. And then you go into the range of the 50s, where you find many Latin American countries and countries in Africa, and even you come to the range of 60, where you find countries like South Africa. So this is kind of a real range. You will see later, or maybe I should mention it even now, that for the world, that number is going to be higher, that number is going to be 7. So it gives you a little bit of a feeling how big is the global inequality. If the global inequality between all citizens in the world is at around 70 or possibly even higher, and think of the difference between 70 degrees temperature and 25 degrees temperature. I don't think that actually anybody would have doubts like which one is more pleasant. So I want to show here on this is what is called unbalanced panel. Is essentially it is not the same countries over the years, but what you can notice there is generally speaking you have had a decline in inequality up to around 1980s, and it's a very common theme. You know, for the rich countries, essentially the turning point was between 79 and 1982, and it's almost uniform. And then what also happened is it was a turning point for China as well, because people forget there were actually around 78 three major revolutions, economic revolutions. Margaret Thatcher with England, with the UK, Ronald Reagan with the United States, and then Xi Jinping in China. Actually, it could be that the third one is the most dramatic one in its historical prospects. And so we have an increase in inequality. Then in the late 80s, early 90s, the transition started. So the countries that used to be communist and with relatively low inequality became much more unequal, with some extreme cases like Russia and Ukraine becoming very unequal. So we have had a period of sort of increasing inequality within nations over the last 25 or 30 years. So that can be seen in any ways that you wish. You know, I've here just sort of shown you some numbers. Essentially, if you take the average Gini of individual countries, you don't have any weighting. Each country counts the same. So basically, you have an increase from 36 to 38. You can then put weights, because more populous countries with more people might actually count more. You basically have the same conclusion. An interesting phenomenon, so I'm not going to read all of that, you can see it, but you know, an interesting phenomenon is illustrated in this graph. So what this graph does is, on the horizontal axis, it tells you what was this Gini coefficient or inequality in 1988, where actually my book also starts, that's why the year 1988 is there. And then what it is in 2011. So these are the relatively complete data for 2011 that I have, because the time lag between until you get all the surveys in all the countries is really basically 4 to 5 years. So unfortunately, I cannot have the world income distribution data like annually, because simply it's impossible. Now, impossible because of lack of data. Now, what it shows you, and each country is shown there by the size of the dots. So bigger countries have bigger dots. Notice one interesting thing. Most of the countries are above this 45-degree line, indicating that inequality went up. So it's not a surprise, so we expect it. But there is a little bit of a surprise at the very top. You notice these countries like Brazil and Mexico, and this is generally the case for Latin American countries. The countries that are traditionally, and they still remain, very, very unequal. But they show a trend which is in the opposition to everybody else. They show a trend of a decline in inequality within countries. Brazil has been extremely well studied, and of course you would kind of think that it was Lula's presidency, which is partly true, but it started even before under Cardoso, and followed generally processes that Western Europe followed maybe 60, 70 years ago, large increase in education, increase in the minimum wages, and very large program of very modest social transfers, but including more than 50 million people. But it is true for other Latin American countries. So what is interesting here, and I want to address that to students, because this is an issue that has not been studied, and we don't have a story for that, but you might want to write your doctoral dissertation, PhD dissertation or something, is that we do have some process of convergence of inequality. In other words, the countries that used to be very equal, like Sweden, for example, or formerly socialist countries, have become significantly more unequal. Sweden is a very good example. It is a country that is still, obviously, quite equal, but inequality went up substantially in the last 20 years. On the other hand, you have countries that are traditionally very unequal, like here you see Brazil, Argentina, Mexico, and so on, which have become a little bit less unequal. So So we don't have a sort of in a tempi theory on what is behind the observed convergence in levels of inequality. But as I said before, the broad picture is that in about two-thirds of the countries, if not three-fourths of the countries, inequality went up in the last period. When I say last period, I mean basically from the end of the Cold War until the global financial crisis, and maybe a little bit in during the crisis as well. But you know, it did not increase in every country equally. So I like this graph to show you what I like it, and actually people like it because it shows you what is underlying the rise of inequality, and it shows you the importance of national policies. Now, the graph obviously illustrates the US and Germany. Now, I would like you to start thinking first of the top line, which is the red line. That line is also a Gini coefficient, and you saw that line going, you see that line going up. And you see it actually in the case of Germany, even going up more than in the case of the United States. Now, that line shows you that income inequality, or what the economists call market income, which is simply income before government redistribution and government direct taxation. So essentially that means you come with your labor, human capital, you get a wage, then you have other sources of income like from assets and so on, and then you have social transfers. Now you notice that line, as I mentioned, in the case of Germany goes up even more dramatically than in the case of the United States. So underlying inequality, be it because of wages or because of the distribution of assets, has really increased. And we'll find that red line in all rich countries going up. But then you have the two other lines. The green line shows you how much inequality is reduced through the action of government transfers. So obviously, you're going to have the green line going down very substantially. In the case of Germany, it really goes down a lot, largely because of transfers like pensions and others, but pensions are really the lion's share of them. And then the third line, which is the blue line, shows you final distribution, which also includes the fact that there are direct taxes that are paid, and obviously that blue line is going to be below the green line because direct taxes are progressive. So what this graph shows is that although the underlying forces in the rich countries which pushed inequality up were similar, the government response was not something to be basically ignored, to be ignored or to essentially dismiss. Because the government response, as you can see in the case of Germany versus the United States, was different. In the case of the US, the government response did not change in reaction to this underlying increase in the red line. In the German case, you can argue, the government response was more proactive. In other words, if there is an increase in the underlying market inequality, well, I will start doing maybe more taxation, more progressive taxes, or I would increase the focus of social transfers. In some cases, it happens directly because you have unemployment benefits, which anyway kick in if there is an increase in unemployment. So, in other words, I would, just to summarize, I would say that the rich countries, well, including obviously OECD countries like Slovenia, have been subjected to very similar forces of globalization. They have very similar structures of labor force, levels of education, and exposure to international markets. But the government reaction was not always the same, and there was a place for government reaction to offset the forces of globalization or technological change, which pushed inequality up. So this is simply a couple of slides for within national inequalities, and I just see here listed some of the issues that we have recently had to kind of address and think much more than in the past about when it comes to within national inequality. You know, as you can see, there were issues of social separatism of the rich lack of interest in social infrastructure, lack of interest in funding public education or public health systems, all these issues that are related to a potential formation of an underclass of people who are poor and who cannot escape from that poverty. And there is also an interesting, I'm not going to read them all, but there is also an interesting issue, which is a difference, and a nice topic also for dissertation, difference between perceptions of inequality and reality. And I think particularly in Slovenia, you will be very sensitized to that, because what I've heard from, you know, my friends here and other people, we know that measured inequality, Slovenia is one of the most unequal, most equal countries in the world. However, people's perception of inequality does not always match that. Actually, many people believe that inequality in Slovenia may be high. So there are currently some studies, particularly it was triggered by the Arab Spring, where really in terms of measured inequality, one could not find that there was inequality in Egypt or Tunisia suddenly went up. But the perception of inequality might have gone up, or the inequity or injustice that is related to inequality might have gone up. But as I said, it is yet one new topic, and yet relatively unexplored and worthwhile sort of thing. So let me then go to the second component of global inequality, which is inequality between nations. Now, the first component, I think, is very clear. This is a component of, like, how much, how unequal is my country. So it's actually everybody thinks it does. The second is also very common, but it's a little bit different. It is thinking about what is on average, because here we will deal with the mean incomes, what is the, on average the difference between a rich country and a poor country. So this is a way that, of course, we generally think, but that average difference in incomes spreads along the entire distribution. So let me then show you this graph, which illustrates where the different countries, where different countries are in the global income distribution, actually where their own distributions in the globe. So let me first define the axis. In the bottom, the horizontal axis is showing you domestic or national income distribution. And let me bring then first the United States so that I can more easily explain. You actually say to the people who are, let me see if this is going to work. I want to show the, I'm not sure. Well, let's suppose you take people who are about the 40th or the 60th percentile in the US income distribution. And you say, okay, this is your income, you're there at the 40th percentile. Where do you think you would be in the global income distribution? The answer would be given to you on the vertical axis. Now, if you're a smart guy, you would actually say, okay, I live in the United States, this person told me I'm at the 40th decile in the United States, should I be above the 40th decile in the world or below? Well, it is, should be immediately clear that you should be above the 40th percentile because you live in a rich country, so being at the 40th percentile in the rich country probably means that you're going to be higher than the 40th percentile when you include all the world, including obviously poor countries. And then you can see, actually, if you look from the 40th percentile, you will probably find the dot for the United States around the 90th percentile in the world. So this is what this graph shows you. And it shows you that as you go further, obviously, to the right, you're going not only to be rich within the United States, you're going to be rich also within the world. And it shows you that the top 12% of Americans are part of the global top 1%. And also shows you that in significant numbers, because this is by percentile, even the poorest of Americans are above the world median, which is the 50th percentile in the world. So now, how would that look if I start bringing like other countries? Now, this is slightly exaggerated because it is a little bit older numbers, so it is now somewhat higher, but it is a striking fact, which still is the case, that countries that are poor, like India, would actually not only have people who are the poorest in the world, which is, I think, not surprising because that's what we would expect, that many people in India who are at the bottom also are bottom in the world. What is surprising is that even people who are at the 80th percentile of their income distribution in India would be below that red line, which is the minimal kind of income in the United States. So these gaps, as you can see, are quite large. The next country is China, which as every year practically, I have that on this graph, but I don't have such detailed data for China 2011 and 13, but of course China keeps on sort of going up, essentially it shifts its position upwards. But you see already here that China shares with India and many poorer countries the fact that you have extremely poor people in those countries. But you can also see that there is a very strong sort of upward part of Chinese income distribution. And if I were to break China into rural and urban, it would actually become even much more significant. Now, the next country is shows both itself, Russia, which you see actually large middle class that appears there around the 80th percentile, both in Russia and in the world. But you can also interpret that line, and I was a little bit kind of slightly surprised when I did it, as really China urban. Actually, China urban very much looks like Russia looks in this picture, which of course tells you that China total, if we divide it into rural and urban, would have a rural component which would be below, which would be between China and India. So, and I'll finish with one country. I will then first let you try to guess which country it is. As you can see, that's a country that has people who are poorest in that country, but they're also at a very, very low level of income. So they're also among the poorest people in the world. It is a country which has a sizable middle class, because you can see the green line, you know, people who are 80s and 90s percentile in the world, and has a top 1%. So obviously that country has to be a very unequal country because it essentially mimics the world. The world distribution on this graph would be actually a 45 degree line. So very unequal countries would have a feature like that. So after I've shown you this idea, let me illustrate it on two examples which I think you might find interesting. First, you can obviously pick up, and I've done that many times, very different countries. Of course, this graph is supposed to illustrate the fact that very rich and egalitarian European countries would have almost no so-called overlap with poor countries in Africa. In other words, it is not simply that at every given percentile of the income distribution, Danes are richer than Malians. We know that, it's obvious. If I'm given the mean income or the median income of Mali and Denmark, I know that I would choose Denmark. But what is interesting there is that actually even the very richest people from Mali or Tanzania, I'm talking not about individuals, but about 1% of them, because you need to have sufficient number of them, they're actually still poorer than the very poorest people in Denmark. Again, it doesn't mean that there is not a homeless guy in Copenhagen who is poorer than, you know, somebody who is, I don't know, president of Tanzania. It just shows you that there is not like 3 million Tanzanians who have an average income that is higher than the average income of the bottom percentile of Denmark. And then I did actually some small exercise where I put also Slovenia, that was 2011 numbers. And I put it with two other rich countries like Germany and Italy, and then I put two poorer countries like Romania and Macedonia. Now, what is interesting there is obviously it's not a surprising thing that actually Germany dominates at every point of the income distribution. The red line is now drawn at the point of the German minimum income, which as you can see is about whatever, I think it would be 10% of population in Slovenia is having the level of income which is below the German minimum. What is interesting, actually, I thought that Slovenia at the very bottom dominates Italy. And then Italy starts in the middle class dominating Slovenia, and I think that it dominates Slovenia at the very top. Because Slovenia is relatively equal, it doesn't, the upper middle class and the top income distribution in Italy is richer, but at the very bottom, as you can see, Italy, which is in red, is actually poorer. The people who are there are poorer than equivalent people, or the equivalent percentile in Slovenia. Now, of course, Romania and Macedonia are both poorer than the three countries that we have here, the three rich countries, but they also show a difference in the sense that one is having greater pockets of poverty and lies below the other one, but then takes over and at the top becomes richer. So in other words, I think that while we have sort of a general rules that obviously richer countries would then be generally higher, at higher positions than the poorer, that doesn't apply throughout the distribution. You can have, as we saw in the case of Italy and Slovenia, you can have poor people relatively poorer than equivalent people in the other country, and then richer people relatively richer than the equivalent people in your comparative country. So there are two issues with these large differences in income rates. One of them is a political philosophy issue, which I call in my book the citizenship rent, and also it's essentially the issue of acceptance, philosophical acceptance of large gaps in incomes between individuals, which are unique only due to the fact that they were born in a richer country. So it's essentially that's a question that you have to ask yourself, that whereas generally speaking in each individual country, we are against inequalities which are due simply to your being born to richer parents, we never ask that question at a global level, whether we should do something about inequalities that are simply due to people being born in poorer countries, or in richer countries for that matter. The rational being that neither being born in a poor or rich country, nor being born to poor and rich parents, nor being born female or male, nor being born white or black, is intrinsically sort of something for which you should be essentially paid. In other words, it's not a result of your effort, but it's a result of the circumstances that is sort of conventionally defined or exogenous. I will not talk much more about that because it's a big topic, but I just want to show how the political philosophy topics are connected and related to very empirical work that, for example, people like me do. And then finally, I would also say a few words about the other topic which derives from these large differences in country incomes, which is the topic of migration, because obviously it is a topic extremely important nowadays in Europe especially. Now, I come to global inequality, and I would actually now try to speed up a little bit my presentation. Let me first give you an overview, historical overview. We obviously don't have very good data from the 19th century global inequality. I'm using Bourguignon and Morrison data series, which practically is the only one, and don't ask me too much how they derived that. It's based, the GDP per capita are based on Madison's data, that's reasonably okay, but then estimates of distributions are very sort of dubious. Nevertheless, what we know is that at the time of the Industrial Revolution, let's say, the global Gini, as I told you today, is 70, used to be about 50. What has happened since then, and that you should really think of this as essentially a big bang. What happened is that the gaps between also Europe and Asia, in terms of mean incomes, were relatively modest. We are talking about the gap between Netherlands and England on one hand, and China of about 3:1 to 4:1. Then what happened with the development with the Industrial Revolution, you had a big bang. Some countries from Northern Europe and the United States, or Western Europe rather, became rich. As they became rich and their populations increased, the gap was created between themselves and other large parts of the world, in particular India and China. So what you see there is really the rising inequality was essentially driven by the process of divergence. In other words, by rich countries becoming rich and large parts of the world remaining as poor as they were in the early 19th century. So that process continued, and as you can see, the increase was less and less because it was some kind, you know, of a concave curve. So towards the end, you have a kind of a plateau. Then the red numbers are much better numbers based on cost of service that come from Lakner, Milanovic, and my own work. And there you see now the decline of global inequality. Now, why is the global inequality declining now? Well, for those who figured out that first part of the process, the answer is very simple. Because now we have a reversal to some extent of the process which drove global inequality up in the 19th century and throughout most of the 20th century. We have the rise of Asia, or the resurgent Asia, with millions of people, or actually with China and India, with 1.3 billion people, becoming richer and converging, although they are still far, particularly India, but converging toward rich countries' income levels. Search process now is set in motion. And if you were to project growth rates for China and India of the level, let's suppose 6% for China and India, maybe 7 or 8% for the next 20 or 30 years, precisely what China has already done before, you would actually have that process of convergence really, and of course assuming that Europe and the United States grow at 1 or 2%, you would really have that process of convergence driving this red line down. So what I want to say here is very important to realize that while you might have increases in inequality in each individual country, you still can have, and as we do now, the decline of global inequality. The two things are not, they are not mutually exclusive. It doesn't, you know, doesn't mean that increases in individual countries' inequality are good. They do contribute to global inequality, but the force which is actually even stronger and more important is the force of growth or, you know, economic convergence between the countries. So after I've explained this, in this graph, I essentially, for the three periods in time, I take this global inequality and divide it into two components. One is the locational component, which is basically the part which of inequality due to the differences in mean country incomes. So basically location, as I said before, is actually difference in mean incomes between rich and poor countries all over with each bilateral comparison. So, you know, you would have countries like Spain comparing their income with Morocco, with Algeria, with France, and so on. A country like Slovenia would compare its income with all the other countries. And then you calculate a number, which is the location component, which is a part of the global inequality. So global inequality in 1850, as you can see here, and as you saw even before, was around 50 or 55 Gini points. About half of that, or a little bit more than half of that, was due to the red component, which is location. Another half, or 45%, was due to within national inequality. Now, notice what happens now in as the time progresses, is that by now you have actually have the red component being the dominant component by far. So most of inequality today is due to inequality between mean country incomes, which of course makes migration such a big force, because migration is a way obviously for you to, you know, increase your income by 4 or 5 times or 10 times. And the class component, because of the decline of inequalities historically in the West compared to what they were in the 19th century, has shrunk. But what will happen in the future? In the future, as I said before, if Asia continues growing much faster than the rich world, when with so many people, you would have the shrinkage of the location component. So the location component starts becoming smaller, reduces global inequality. If within national inequalities keep on rising, or even if they stay where they are, you would have an increase in the within national component, or that gray component. And why I called it from Karl Marx to Franz Fanon and back to Marx, because the first distribution in 1850 was, although of course Marx didn't know these numbers, but actually it's a distribution that can largely justify the idea of international solidarity between workers or between poor people. Because if you have largest inequality being, or large inequality being due to within national, that essentially means that in every individual country you have poor people sort of against facing rich people. Because most of inequality is due to the within national class structure. But then, nowadays, or actually the last 30 years or 50 years, Most of inequality was due to the differences in locations. And that's why we had, in those days, actually when I studied, we had the Third World. And that's why I used Franz Fanon, because he was one of the people with, for example, Mao too, who redefined the class struggle as being a struggle between the proletariat, which is geographically located in the Third World, and the bourgeoisie, which is geographically located in the rich world. But that story will not survive this particular change in the distribution that I described, whereby, of course, Asian countries and hopefully in the future also African countries become richer and reduce the location component. So what I think this graph illustrates is the very fact that actually some of our political ideas are very largely made sensible or not sensible by the empirical changes in the income distribution in the world. And just think of that, I will not go into that, but for many of us who have studied or been impressed by dependencia theories and the like, we don't have any more the tool which makes any sense within that context. Because the world, there is no more of that gap between the North and the South. There is no more stories that actually sort of delinking from the rich world is going to bring you prosperity. So the entire sort of, I believe, the entire view of the world, which was shaped in the 60s by that North-South debate, the North-South contrast, was based on the world where location was dominant. If location becomes less dominant, these theories, as we have seen them now in practice, have become much less relevant. And then, these are actually just simply, I want to mention three technical issues before I just finish with the elephant graph, which Joshua has already described, so I will go quickly over that. I want to mention, so that just to give you an idea, that what I'm showing you here is the best possible that we can do now. Every year, I think we can do a little bit better, but we are still far from having really a very satisfactory state of data and knowledge that I think, I'm sure, the next generation would have. And when I compare what I have today with what I actually had in 1999 when I published the first paper, it's a huge difference. And of course, nothing like that would have been at all published because we didn't have surveys from more than half of the world. Nothing like that could have been published in 1985. So I think we would actually do better in the next 10 or 20 years. But we have problems. We have problems, as I mentioned before, that this price level, the so-called PPP, oscillates very wildly, particularly in Asian countries where we measure it. There were some allegations that China intentionally sort of played with these numbers. I don't think they're fully justified. But in any case, when you have large changes in the measured price level, that means that there are large changes in the estimate of real income of people who live there. Now, if you make that large change, for example, from Slovenia, it's not going to affect global income distribution. But when you make this large change for China and India, it affects very significantly global income distribution. Because if I find the Chinese price level is higher suddenly, in one measurement, because these measurements are done at every 5 or 6 years, then everybody in China suddenly becomes poor. Because I actually have to kind of adjust their income level by saying they face a higher price level. So that's a problem of non-stability of price measurements in Asia in particular, because for OECD countries, the measurement is fairly stable, so we don't have much of a change there. The second problem is that we have noticed, and this leads to the third problem, so I can also treat them jointly, we have noticed that there was a rapid discrepancy between the data that we get in household surveys, which are actually showing sometimes much smaller increase compared to the GDP number. And most of that discrepancy comes from the fact that the very top of the income distribution is becoming more and more difficult to actually include in household surveys. People have always underestimated their income, especially income from capital, and being rich, they are actually less willing to participate in surveys. So one of the big issues that we also face with people like Piketty who work on fiscal data, because they have their own problems there, is how can we combine fiscal data, which are actually better for the top of income distribution, with household survey data, which give us the entire distribution. So this is one of the big, I think, areas for future work. We have done several attempts to do that, but you know, we don't have a really good solution because it's very difficult to have a solution for something that you don't observe. So if you don't observe, actually, rich people decide not to participate in the survey, it's difficult to impute their incomes simply because, you know, you don't have information about them. So let me then go to the elephant graph, and what was the title here is that actually what happened between the fall of the Berlin Wall and the Great Recession. So I'm over my time. I will just finish with this. So then this is just to give you an idea of what is included in these numbers. This is the number of surveys that actually is in each year. This is, as you can see, it's about 120 surveys per year. And you can also notice one thing, well, it is actually population coverage, that while the population coverage for the world is pretty good, we have significant problems in Africa in particular, where the population coverage is not sufficient, and the numbers that I'll show you now are really underestimates of global inequality, because we are really systematically undercovering or not covering sufficiently very poor countries in Africa, and in many cases countries that don't have surveys simply because they are in wars or, you know, facing other types of conflicts. So let me then finally show, I will skip this part because it is, I might come to that later, but in order to save some time, the graph that actually I don't need to explain practically at all because Yoshi has already explained it. This is the elephant graph, and it has, of course, attracted so much attention because in one slide it essentially sort of shows who were the winners, if you will, relative winners and relative losers of globalization. Now, the relative winners, not surprisingly, and you have already heard it, are the middle classes of Asia, who are relatively poor because, as you can see, they are around the 50th percentile of the world income distribution, but they have increased on average their income, they have doubled, and many groups, for example, in China and elsewhere, Thailand as well, they have actually increased it by 4 or 5 times. So we are talking about really massive increases in percentage. In percentage terms. Now, the other group that actually is, you can call it group B, is people who are richer, because as you can see, they are about the 80th global percentile, but they have not seen much of an increase in their incomes. And 70% of people in that group are actually from what you can call all OECD countries, but not all the distribution of those countries. Only the lower part of the distribution of those countries. Because that's where the lower part of the distributions of those countries are. They are actually people who are around the 80th percentile of the world. So they are actually relative losers. And that's why, of course, you know, people have discussed this graph in the context of Brexit or Trump or maybe Le Pen or maybe Alternative for Deutschland or whatever else you can imagine. And of course, the other point of gain are people who are actually top 1% globally and who have had also major increase. Now, I have to say that that graph is accurate as far as it goes, but it does actually hide certain things, or doesn't show them. For example, if I were to show the same graph by looking at absolute gains, then the situation would look different. And why would it look different? Because the world is so unequal that actually even very small gains, or you know, of 1 or 2 percentage points, among that U.S. lower middle class might be greater, and actually were greater in absolute sense than even these large doublings of real income in Asia. So in other words, if you know I have $10 a day and then doubles to $20, so I need a 100% increase, and this will be shown as 100% increase. But then somebody else who is much richer than I has, you know, has $1,000. He just needs like 1% of the increase to actually have the same absolute increase as I did. From 10 to 20, he just needs another 10, which would be only 1% of his income. So, you know, the absolute numbers are a little bit are different from the relatives. Although we do actually work normally in income distribution with relatives, and there are good reasons why we do so. So the last thing that I would like to show is that if you pull this and update this to 2011, you still have the elephant graph, basically, which looks very much like the previous one, but there are two small differences. First, there is now much bigger gain in the middle because Asian countries have continued growing, you know, at very high rates, actually. China increased, you know, at the median by almost 40% between 2008 and 2011. On the other hand, the very top of the income distribution now does not show almost this parity in like the same increase as before because they've been affected by the financial crisis. So the very top of the income distribution was affected by the financial crisis and they lost out. And because that very top of the global income distribution is made predominantly of people in the rich countries, that's why we have some slower increase at the very top. And to show you that, so I will skip things, other things, I want to show you one graph, which I think it is with the graph with the effects of the crisis, which actually nicely illustrates that actually quite dramatically. This is not in the book, this is much more recent. And the blue line, it is what is called growth in sinus curve. So this is the United States, from the poorest people again to the richest. Notice first that practically everybody is the negative area. I don't know if you can read, but the zero is there in the middle, and very few people are above zero. So basically, most of the people are losing. But notice the blue line. The blue line is the first period of the crisis, 2007 to 2010. And that blue line shows this really dramatic decline. Well, there was a decline everywhere, but it was very dramatic at the very top. Notice the red line, which is then the next period. So the red line is almost the mirror image of the blue line. And that particular pattern is of the crisis, like two steps in the crisis. The first step, more or less everybody loses, but the rich lose even more. The second step, more or less situation is the same, maybe a little bit better, but who gains the most is the rich. That I want to show you, just look at the blue and red line. This is for Germany, this is for the Netherlands. So that particular pattern is very present actually in most of the rich countries. So at the end of the period, the distribution has not changed very much. There are really small changes in the distribution, but and the rich have not really gained much in 2013 compared to 2007, which then explains that the very top of the income, global income distribution is not as high now as it was in the original graph in 2008.